Realizing the American Dream on BCTV is supported by the Santander Bank.
Bingo. All right. Good evening, everybody, and welcome to Realizing the American Dream. Hope everybody's having a good night. Felt a little bit like spring or fall tonight, but I think it's getting cold the rest of the week. And then guess what? If you're living here in the Pennsylvania area, looking for more rain. Imagine that. Something new. Hey, but on the good side, Halloween's coming. That should be fun. Tonight, what I want to do is let's start out with this. After the Fed meeting, really not too much happened there because that was kind of business as usual. It was pretty much what everybody expected as far as what the Federal Reserve did. They bumped rates 0.25%. Statement came out, blah, blah, blah. Everything was as expected. However, after that, we got some more hot economic news. And what it did is it kind of spooked the markets a little bit. Unemployment is really, really low, and that's going to produce some wage pressure or inflationary pressures on wages. So the Fed starts worrying about inflation, and that incents it to start increasing rates a little bit faster. That's what's scaring the market right now. Or maybe the traders just like to move stuff around because they don't get paid unless you're moving money around. If you're sitting there watching your stocks go up, they don't make any money. So, if we create a crisis or two, it's all good. But in what the result of that was over the last week or two, rates popped up maybe 0.25% to 0.375%, depending on which bank you're looking at. So things are up a little bit. Bond market recovered a little bit today because the stock market was off a bit. But the fundamentals of the stock market are still strong. Most of the businesses are doing really well. You know, one earnings report here or there isn't going to make that much of a difference realistically with the rest of the market moving forward. So, you know, all that being said, still the projection is the same. Probably interest rates are going to keep moving up. We have that upward trending thing, even though you see a little bit of a sawtooth here and there. You may get a day where the rates may pop down an eighth here or there, but you know, in the long run, we're looking at just an increasing pattern, which is tracking the economy, basically. So all that being said, what I wanted to do tonight is if you're a first-time homebuyer, even if you're not a first-time homebuyer, most people, unless you're an investor, do not buy homes or get mortgages too many times in your lifetime. So there's a lot of mortgage jargon and a lot of words out there that get thrown around. And as a banker, sometimes we forget that you as a consumer don't necessarily have a full understanding of those words. You hear them and you may perceive them differently. So tonight what I wanted to do is I'm just going to run through kind of a quick glossary of terms that you might hear if you're applying for a mortgage, whether it's a refinance or a purchase or a construction loan, wherever it might be. A lot of these terms are going to be the same. At least it'll give you a little bit of an idea, a basic idea of what we're talking about when we go rambling off with our bank lingo, so to speak. So let's pop over to the board. I have a whole lot of words to go through, so I'm going to pop through them pretty quickly. If anybody has questions, raise your hand. We'll talk about it later. No, I'm just kidding. You know, call your banker. They should be glad to explain anything to you, or you can find these definitions online too. So let's go over to the board here and take a look at these things. All right, so I did them in alphabetical order just to make my life easy because I was just, kind of writing things down in that order. So let's just start at the top here. Addendum. Okay, so an addendum, that's just something that's added on. Basically, the addendum when it comes to real estate or mortgage terms is usually an addendum to your contract. So if you've already got an agreement of sale, what happens is sometimes it has to be changed, things have to be adjusted, so they may draw up an addendum. ARM. Adjustable rate mortgage, that's pretty straightforward. I guess you guys kind of know what that is. We've talked about that numerous times. It's just a mortgage that's fixed for a period of time and then can adjust. AGI, this is adjusted gross income. If you're a self-employed borrower, what we do is we look at your tax returns. So when it comes to AGI, that's that number on the bottom of the bottom of the first page of your tax return. And that's usually after the deductions and stuff come out, it adds up your total income. Then on page two, there's some other stuff that gets factored in there. But adjusted gross income usually gives us a pretty good idea what your income levels are. AOS, that's just an abbreviation for agreement of sale. Very important if you're buying a home. Amortize or amortization. Amortization is the term that refers to how your loan is broken down over a period of time. When you look at an amortization table, what it does is for a regular mortgage, even though the payment stays the same, what happens is at each payment, the amount of interest you pay will go down and the amount of principal you pay will go up as you proceed through the loan. So that's amortization, because what it's doing is interest is accruing based on the outstanding principal balance at that point in time. That's why the interest goes down every time, because every month you have a lower outstanding principal balance until you get to the end of the loan, whether it's a 15-year, 30-year, whatever it is, and then you're at zero, which is a good thing. APR, that's your annual percentage rate. This is not the actual rate that you're paying. When you get a loan, you may get a rate of, let's just say, 4%. But if you look at the APR may say, okay, well, the APR is actually 4.325 or something like that. It's usually a weird number, because what the APR does is it includes the cost of getting the loan. So there's a formula that the federal government uses, or they say that we have to use, is you back in the bank costs into the loan amount, then you amortize it out over the life of the loan, and that's where the APR comes from. Supposedly, it's a fair way to compare two lenders to each other, although there's kind of ways to cheat the system, and some lenders will do that, like if they build points in. Even though you're paying more closing costs, it looks like your APR is lower. So you got to be careful with that too. Application. This just refers to the actual application. You fill it out when you actually formally make applications, when you decide to proceed with it and have everything submitted to be underwritten and looked at by the bank. Appraisal. This is the valuation of the property. Whether you're doing a refinance or a purchase, Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac require appraisals in almost every file. There are some exceptions now where they will allow a waiver on that if there's a lot of good comparable sales on record in the area and they can estimate a really good value of your property, or if you have a lot of equity in the property. So sometimes that can be waived, but the appraisal is just an estimate of value that can be supported by comparable sales. Appreciate or appreciation, that just refers to if your property is increasing in value. It's called appreciation or appreciating. Assessment, this has to do with your taxes. What happens is the actual real estate taxes that you pay, even though the appraisal may be one thing, the assessed value that the county uses is what your taxes are based on. So for example, in Berks County, if your appraisal is $300,000, the county is going to use a lesser number than that because we have not done a countywide reassessment since 1994. So they're going to adjust that to try to equalize older properties and newer properties, because obviously if you bought your property recently, it's going to cost more than if you bought it in 1994. So all that being said, the assessment is what they base your taxes on. Assumable, this refers to a type of loan feature, which means that in some cases, and very few, like regular fixed rate loans are not normally assumable, but what an assumable loan is, it just means that if you sell your home to somebody, they might just be able to take your loan over instead of getting their own loan. FHA loans have this feature sometimes. There's only a couple special cases where this applies. AU, automated underwriting. This is a thing that exists with Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. What they did back in the late 90s is they created this system where we basically type all the information into our system, your particulars, whether it's your credit score, you know, what your debt levels are, your income, all that stuff. It then gets translated and run through a system with Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac in their computer, and it looks at all the parameters of your loan, and then it comes back and says, okay, we approve this loan. So then all that our underwriters do is just verify that we typed the information in correctly, but Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac actually approve the loan. This is kind of where part of the mortgage crisis came from, because what they did is, and you know, Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac were approving all these loans, but then they're blaming it on the banks for, you know, doing the loans that they approved. So it was kind of a strange situation, but that's what automated underwriting is. Balloon. Not too many of these around anymore, balloon mortgages. What they are, it's kind of like an adjustable rate mortgage. They're fixed for a number of years. And then at a certain point along the way, it balloons, which means that basically you have to pay the loan off. So you either have to come up with the cash to pay it off, or you can refinance it. But it has to be paid off. So you may have a 7-year balloon, which means you pay on it for 7 years. At the end of that 7 years, you have to pay that loan off. Otherwise, the bank can foreclose on you. So, you know, they had their moment in time, but not too many places do them anymore. Bankruptcy, that's a pretty easy one. Just refers to, you know, if you've ever gone bankrupt, you know, and that has an effect. They pop up on the credit report if you've done that, and then that affects what we can do as far as the underwriting and what types of loans we can do a lot of times. Over here, oops, can I hook in the chair with my phone? There. There we go. All right, biweekly, this refers to a special loan feature also. What that means is instead of paying monthly on it, you're just paying every 2 weeks. Some people use this feature to pay their loan down a little more quickly. you know, is it beneficial? Is it not beneficial? It depends on your circumstance. Some people just like to get their loan paid off. Realistically, I did a show a few months back where we talked about, is it more beneficial to put mortgage into investment or put money into investments or to apply it to your mortgage to try to pay it off sooner? Depends on where your interest rate is and what the return on your investments are. But in most cases, assuming the stock market returns about 10% annually, historically, it's probably better to put the money into investments than to try to pay your loan down. But again, it comes back to your comfort level. Break even. I usually use this when I'm looking at refinancing. When it comes to refinancing, it's a question of, are you better off refinancing or not refinancing? And what you have to look at is what the cost of doing the refinance is and how much you're going to save and how long you're going to be in the property. So if your cost is $2,000 and you're going to save $100 a month, your break-even period would be 20 months. It's just the $2,000 divided by the $100 a month that you're saving. So I usually use this as a barometer to help people maybe gauge whether or not it makes sense for them to do it. Cash out, that's just a term for the type of refinance. You can do a number of different types of refinance. You can either do a cash out refinance or you can do what's called a rate and term refinance. If you're doing a cash out refinance, that means you're paying off something other than just your primary loan and the closing costs. And that has a little bit more cost to it because it's considered a little higher risk because you're taking extra cash out for something. A rate and term refinance, you know, I'm skipping ahead here a little bit, just means that you're paying off your primary loan and you're paying off whatever closing costs are associated with doing the loan. Cash reserves. In some cases, certain loans do require reserves when you go to settlement. In most cases, you really don't need that, but like first-time homebuyer loans and some of these other programs may say, okay, well, you need 2 months' worth of reserves out there to show that you have them available if you lose your job or something like that. Not that you keep them there, you know, after settlement, but you know, we just make sure that it's there at least when you go to settlement. So you have a little bit of reserve cash to go on if you do get in trouble. Cash to close, a simple thing. It's just the amount of money you need for settlement. For a refinance, most of the time we can roll the closing costs and stuff in. For a purchase, we're looking at your down payment plus your closing costs is going to normally add up to your cash to close. CO, that's a certificate of occupancy. This comes in construction loans. If you're doing a construction to permanent type loan where you're actually building a house on a vacant lot or renovating a house or anything like that, at the end of construction, normally the township wants to come out and they want to take a look at the property and inspect it and make sure that it's done up to code. Once they do that, then they'll give you a certificate of occupancy, which says that you can actually live there. It gives you permission to live back in your house. So that's something that comes into play on most construction projects. Closing costs. Closing costs are just the what you need in addition to your down payment or with a refinance, what you need in addition to paying off your existing loan to actually get the deal done. And that is comprised of, you know, paying for your appraisal, application fees, all kinds of stuff like that, whatever those costs may be. CD, this is a relatively new one. This is the closing disclosure. We used to have what was called the HUD sheet, the HUD settlement sheet, and it had a whole bunch of numbers on it. And at settlement, you go and you look over all these numbers, then you sign the sheet at the end and it tells you how much you're getting. This basically does the same thing, it's just a different format. A lot of states were using different types of settlement sheets. And what this did, the government with Dodd-Frank, they tried to make this universal so that everybody's looking at the same thing. They also made this so it looks like what's called the loan estimate, which is also further down the line. So you can compare what you were quoted at the beginning to what you're getting at the end, and everything looks the same, and you can make sure that nobody's trying to pull a fast one on you. CLTV, CLTV and LTV. LTV is just loan to value. That just means the loan amount relative to the value of the property. So if you're borrowing $80,000, the house is worth $100,000, 80 over 100, it's, you know, 80%. So that's what loan to value is. Cumulative loan to value, just refers to if you have maybe more than one loan out there. So if you've got a $80,000 loan and a $10,000 loan, you have a total of $90,000. $100,000 value, cumulative loan to value is 90% instead of the 80% we talked about earlier. Co-borrower, just if you have a second borrower in the loan, simple. Collateral, collateral is the house itself. When it comes to mortgage finance, all we do is we lien property. Commercial can do like blanket loans and stuff, and they can lien other things. But when it comes to residential real estate, we just have to put a lien against the property itself, and that's collateral for the loan or the asset that is backing the loan. Commitment, that is when you are approved. We give you what's called a commitment or commitment letter saying that you're approved for the loan. Conforming, All conforming means is that the thing, the loan itself conforms to Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac guidelines. Most loans in this country do. If the and there's a limit loan limit set on that. Right now it's up to $453,100. Anything above that is what is considered a jumbo loan. So conforming loan, anything that goes Fannie Freddie, jumbo, anything above that. Condo, just type of property. Condos, it's a legality thing. You can structure a property or a development as a group of condos. Same thing with co-op, similar thing. Except in a co-op, you actually own shares of a building. It's like stock. And it gives you, by owning those shares, gives you a right to live in that unit. A co-op, you still actually get a deed with the property, whereas a condo, whereas a co-op, you do not. You get shares of the building. Credit report, simple one. Your credit report just kind of summarizes your credit history and gives a score. DTI, this stands for debt to income ratio. Very, very important parameter when it comes to underwriting loans. We just look at your debt divided by your total income, and it's allowed to be a certain amount, and that varies from loan to loan. But in general cases, it's usually about 50%. In some loans, it may be as low as 38, but you know that's what that comes down to. Deed, that's just, it transfers ownership of the property. It's a piece of paper, it says who owns the property, and it's recorded at the courthouse whenever you buy something. Depreciation, appreciation was increasing in value, depreciation is decreasing value. Don't usually want to see that with your house though. Down payment, pretty simple. That's the amount of money you're putting down. You know, $100,000 house, $10,000, you're putting 10% down. Pretty straightforward. Isn't this exciting? All right, here we go. Equity, equity in the property. So again, if you put $10,000 down, that 10% is the amount of equity you've got in that property. It's the amount that you own, the amount of that asset that you actually have ownership of. Escrow, this used to mean a couple different things. In California, they used to say if you're going to put a property into escrow, if you're purchasing it, they had a whole different purchase process out there. This is one of the states, like I said, they tried to unify everything, so everybody's doing it the same way now. But in California, they had a whole different process. Escrow normally refers to an account that is set up by the bank. And what it does is you actually make payments to it throughout the year for maybe taxes, insurance, things like that. Take the annual figure and divide it by 12. That's usually what goes in there unless there's adjustments being made for shortages or overages. But the escrow account then pays those tax and insurance bills. Holy poop, I'm down in 10 minutes. All right, I got to start flying here. Freddie Mac, Fannie Mae, Federal Home Loan Mortgage Corporation, Federal National Mortgage Association. All right. FHA, Federal Housing Administration. Okay, these are all just government entities that back mortgage loans. Fixed rate, self-explanatory. That means your rate doesn't move. Floating, this is a term that refers to your rate prior to going to settlement. If you elect to float, it can change before you go to settlement. If you elect to lock in, you can fix it and make sure that it doesn't change on you before you get there. Gift letter, this is something if you're getting a gift from a family member, we have to get a letter signed saying it's an actual gift, not a loan. Grant, there's programs out there that give you grants towards closing costs maybe. There's a number of different organizations out there that provide those things. In most cases, they don't have to be paid back. In some, they do. So these are things that we have to take a look at. Gross income, this is just your total income. We look at that. And then for a self-employed borrower, though, your net income is the one we really want to look at. Hazard insurance or homeowner's insurance, again, self-explanatory. HELOC, home equity line of credit. You're going to see this sometimes. Sometimes you can get a home equity line in conjunction with a mortgage, or you can use a home equity line. There's a special one called the swing loan that you can use to get money out of an old house to purchase a new house. We talked about that in other shows too. HOA, Homeowners Association, special kinds of development. You're going to see that. You're going to have Homeowners Association fees. Interest rate, that's just the rate that you're paying on the loan when you borrow the money. Interim interest, usually when you go to settlement, you have to pay interest from the day you settle to the end of the month. That's your interim interest, okay? Investment property, which means you don't live there, renting it out. Lien, that's what is recorded as a mortgage against the property. The mortgage is actually a lien. Unlike a car loan, when you purchase it, the until you pay off your car loan, the dealer or the owner of the car actually holds your title. With a house, you actually get the deed to the property, which means you own it, but the bank puts a lien against it. So we can come in and foreclose on it if you stop paying it. Loan conditions, this is once you're approved, there may be additional conditions before you go to settlement. LE, loan estimate. This is a thing up front that replaced the good faith estimate. It gives you an idea what all of the closing costs and everything are going to be and what your interest rate, payment, all of that. This is the disclosure that you get up front when you do an application. Loan to value, we talked about that earlier with the loan amount relative to the value of the property. All right, lock in. That just means you can lock your rate between application and settlement. Guarantee it once you get the settlement. Lock expiration, you don't want that lock to expire prior to settlement, otherwise you may lose that locked rate. LIBOR index, that is for adjustable rate loans. It's an index that they usually use. Index plus a margin, that determines what your rate will be when it gets to the adjustable period. Margin index, we just talked about that. Manufactured home and modular. I put these up here just because I want to differentiate. Some people don't understand the difference between these. Manufactured home is like a double wide. It's mobile, okay? Modular home is usually, it's a home that's assembled maybe somewhere else in pieces, and then it comes and it's assembled on a slab or on a lot. So they're a little bit different. And it has to do, it affects your financing too. The mortgage itself is actually a lien that is recorded against the property. That's a big one. The other one over here is the note. These are two big ones you sign at settlement. So you sign the lien, which is the mortgage. The note is actually your promise to pay the money back. So it's a promissory note. Mortgage broker. Unlike a bank, a mortgage broker is usually kind of an intermediate party where they actually go to a bank or go to investors and they purchase the loan. They then have to mark it up. Then they purchase a little bit cheaper because the bank doesn't have the origination costs in there. But then they mark it back up because they've got to make money too. So a mortgage broker is just an intermediary between you and the bank when it comes to getting a loan. Mortgage insurance premium, this is part of an FHA loan. It's a chunk that you pay up front if you don't have that 20% down point. Negative amortization. This has to do with amortization is as you pay your principal balance down. In some special adjustable rate loans, it limited what your payment adjustment would be, but it didn't limit what your interest rate adjustment could be. These were some people got in trouble with these. And because the interest was going higher than what the cap on the payment was, it was negatively amortizing, which means that it was adding to the principal balance instead of paying it down. So most of these loans have gone away. I don't know if anybody does negative amortization loans anymore. NMLS, this is the thing that refers to the licensing group that licenses all loan originators like myself ever since Dodd-Frank was put in place. Everybody has an NMLS number associated with all their marketing and stuff. Owner-occupied, this means you're going to live there. Origination fees. Sometimes the banks will have all kinds of various fees in there. Origination fees, I've heard it's used in a different number of different ways. Sometimes origination fees can just refer to the bank fees. Sometimes it refers to actual points. It just depends on who you're talking to, how they're using it. But just understand the origination fee is probably something to do with the bank. This is something that they're charging you. PUD, planned unit development. Again, this is like condo and co-op. It's just a special legal name for a development, and usually there's common elements to the development. So it's usually single family homes or townhouses that are described as a PUD. This one doesn't really affect you that much, but just understand that it's a different type of legal entity that owns some of the common elements of the development. POA, that is a power of attorney. In some cases, if somebody can't be at settlement, you get a specific power of attorney giving the other person the right to sign stuff. Pre-approval and pre-qual. We talked about this before too on the show. Pre-approval is when you actually get the thing underwritten up front. There's no cost for either of these. Pre-qual, you give me information. It might be verbal. I put it in the system. I run it through the automated underwriting. I say you're approved. Pre-approval, I verify that information by getting pay stubs and stuff. That's the difference. Prepaids at settlement. You have a couple of different things that comprise your closing costs. You're going to have your actual, like your costs and fees and stuff, and you're going to have prepaids. Prepaids are taxes and insurance and interest and stuff that you're paying ahead of time at settlement. So if you're putting money into an escrow account, for example, that's a prepaid. So that is where that comes from. Primary residence, this just refers to the type of property. If you're going to live there and it's going to be your primary home, then it's primary residence. PMI, private mortgage insurance, unless you have 20% down, you have to have PMI, and it's on a monthly basis normally. Your processor, this is somebody who helps me with getting your loan to closing. Once they get everything in the system, get everything done, the processor then takes the loan and does all the back office stuff to it and may contact you for additional conditions. Real estate taxes, these are the taxes that are just levied against the property by the county, state, city, whoever, wherever you live, it's gonna depend, but they're local real estate taxes. Refinance, that's just if you're refinancing or redoing an existing loan. Rescission, after you do a refinance or get a home equity loan, you always have what's called the 3-day right of rescission, which means you have 3 days to change your mind. So it's a government mandated thing. If it's your primary residence, you have 3 days. Even if you sign all the paperwork and do everything, after 3 days, you can still say, nope, I don't want to do it and get all your money back. Most people don't really realize that. Second home, this is also an owner-occupied property, but you're using it as a second home. It's not your primary residence. So there's three types of properties, really. Investment, second home, primary residence. That usually makes the difference. Second mortgage, that's just another name for like a home equity loan or something. In some cases, it can be a fixed rate second mortgage. Maybe you're doing a hybrid, like an 80-10-10 or something like that. But that's usually what a second mortgage is. It's just a second lien that's out there that's recorded against the property. Secondary market, this is Fannie and Freddie and the bond market and all that stuff. And this is why we're so liquid here in the United States. And it's easier to buy a house than almost anywhere in the world because we have the secondary market where people invest in these mortgage-backed securities, making money available to people who want to buy houses. Subordinate, this is also really like second mortgage. Subordinate financing just means it's secondary to another type of financing. Swing loan, talked about this earlier. Again, it's basically a home equity line of credit that you can utilize to draw money out of an existing home for down payment and closing costs on a new home before your existing home is sold. So it's a nice way, you know, depending on the market, you can not make sure you don't lose a house just because your house isn't sold yet. Tax lien, if you don't pay your taxes, they come and lien the property. Like the mortgage, it's a lien recorded against the property. That's the only thing to take first lien position away from the bank, by the way. So the bank hates tax liens. Title insurance, it's something that you get when you go to settlement. What it does is it makes sure that the property, nobody's gonna come back to you after settlement and say, hey, you owe us money for this because they have a claim to that property. Or a past owner didn't pay their taxes or something like that. Title search, that's when the title company goes out and they search the deed to the property and they make sure that there are no existing liens out there that are gonna come back and get you later. Then once that's clear, they give you your title insurance. Transfer tax, when you buy a property, this varies from state to state and area to area. But usually there's some kind of tax that you have to pay to either the state or the city or whatever it might be when you transfer property from one person to another. Underwriter, person who takes a look at your loan and says, yes, you're approved. That's the person we send it to. Again, automated underwriting, in a lot of cases, the underwriter is just making sure that I put the data in properly, but they work for the bank directly. And VA, last but not least, VA. This is Veterans Administration, another government entity that backs loans. If you're VA eligible, the best loan in the world. I'm out of time. Have a great night, and I'll see you guys next month. Take care.
Realizing the American Dream on BCTV is supported by the Santander Bank.